this video, we are looking at the siblings of the family scapegoat, and there's three myths about the siblings that I want to dispel. So let's just name the three myths first, and then we'll go through them. So the first myth is that the siblings work independently of the parents. So this would also imply that they're thinking independently. Myth number two is that time heals all wounds. So that it's at some point in the future that things will just settle down and be okay. The third myth is that once the parents are deceased, that things again can settle down and things will be okay, and the siblings will have an enlightenment moment and see the light, and the relationships between the siblings and you and your siblings will be fine. So let's go through these one by one to dissect them a bit more and understand what's going on. So firstly, with the family scapegoat, the name does what it says on the tin. This person must be isolated, must be rejected, and must be banished from the tribe. To do that, this person cannot have any allies. That is very, very important. So we see that within the family of origin unit within itself, and we also see it in the wider family, the extended family, that this scapegoat is also rejected and ostracized by those people as well, through lies, manipulation, brainwashing, and smear campaigns by the parents of the scapegoat child. So the idea that your siblings might have a mind of their own and might take it upon themselves to bully you, to be cruel to you, let's kind of unpack that for a minute. The parents, when the family is young and all the children are toddlers and growing up, it's the parents' responsibility to guide the children, to raise the children in a healthy way. And within the family unit and family home, the parents are the adults, the parents are the elders, the children are the minors. So a human being is very much influenced by their primary caregivers. They just go along with whatever tone is there, whatever values are there in the family unit. They don't have a say about it, really. It's the way we get wired when we're a young child. So, of course, things are slightly different in a dysfunctional family unit, in that children do not have any independence. Certainly, they don't have any autonomy. And that's even more prevalent as we reach adolescence and a child really wants to break free from the parents and not be hanging on to the parents' apron strings. This is not psychologically allowed in a dysfunctional family unit. So how could the siblings think for themselves and decide that they're going to bully the scapegoat child, their brother or their sister, and they're going to be mean and cruel to them? That would not happen in a healthy family, because the parents would step in, the parents would be very upset, and the parents would create some resolution to that. I mean, in every family, you know, siblings can have squabbles and disagreements, but not to the severity, extent, level of abuse and toxicity that takes place within a dysfunctional family unit. So it's worth having a think about that. Quite often people will message me and say that, you know, almost this thing of my parents are innocent. My parents are victims here because my brother or my sister is the one that's causing all the trouble. So the parents are the ones that allocate the role of a scapegoat within their offspring, within their children. And you can't have a scapegoat without having a golden child and other children in roles. It's not as if there's one child is the family scapegoat and the rest of the family unit is healthy, functional, loving to each other, and, you know, great relationships. That is not that the case at all. Let's just completely dispel that myth. It's a dysfunctional family unit, parents who bully their child, parents who see that their child is hurting, parents who are cruel to their child are not in a healthy, functional family unit. And I think sometimes we might need to just take a step back from that, to give ourselves a bit of distance from the brainwashing, the years, the decades of brainwashing that we have been exposed to, that say, you are the problem here. You are bad, you are wrong, it's all your fault and you're hurting us. So we really want to come away from that brainwashing. We want to recognize it as brainwashing, and we want to release the denial, layers of denial. And part of that denial can be a loyalty to the parents and making excuses maybe for their behavior. So also just one last point on the first myth about this, that the siblings might be working independently or thinking independently. The dysfunctional family unit is like a cult. That is why us as the family scapegoat, we think differently, we see the world differently, we have different ideas, and that is not allowed in the dysfunctional family unit. We are vilified for thinking differently, for asking questions, for not towing the party line. So this is how cults operate. Everybody must think the same. Everybody must have the same values. And then, of course, there's a cult leader. So there's a ringmaster who is enforcing these laws, these regulations. And definitely there is no independence allowed. There is no autonomy allowed. We're coming out of these dysfunctional families with a loss of sovereignty. You're going into adulthood, you don't have really a sense of self or sovereignty or autonomy or independent thinking. So that's dispelling that myth there. Let's move on to myth number two, which is things will improve with the passing of time. So as the scapegoat child, your siblings were trained to treat you in cruel ways. They were trained to ostracize you. They weren't allowed to be friends with you. They were given ideas about who you are as a person. And they, of course, received brownie points for going along with the adults in that situation. And they also, all children in a dysfunctional family are abused children, because their little young minds, as very young children, were witnessing you being crushed to a pulp psychologically from the bullying, from the criticism, from being told you were wrong and bad as a little toddler, as a little child, by the parents. So a child that witnesses that level of domestic violence, child abuse, is going to be impacted by that, is going to be affected by that. Their nervous system is going to be dysregulated with that. So they need to go into a lot of denial. So they have a lot of issues, which are separate to what we have as the family scapegoat. It's like two sides of the same coin. So we can definitely think that, oh, you know, when we're all adults, people will be mature and we won't need to act in these really immature ways that we have done in the past. Perhaps you've been away from the family unit for a while. Perhaps you're coming back for the holidays and you're coming back with enthusiasm and positivity and a lot of hope, because you've probably done a lot of personal development and healing work, and you're walking into that family of origin home and you're thinking, I've got this now. I can handle this, I can deal with this, and we're all going to be a mature family, and there's no need for this immaturity and games and really cruel jokes and mocking and jeering. Like, I'm sure my siblings have matured, and maybe your siblings now have their children as well. So there's another generation coming along. And of course, we would love to cling on to that hope that things would improve over time. The thing about that is, if we believe that myth, it could be a case that we're not quite understanding the severity of the neural wiring that goes in with the brainwashing, the decades, the years of brainwashing in that dysfunctional family system. And think of the hours and hours that you've spent with the parents. Think of the hours and hours, weeks, years, months, decades that the siblings have spent in the company of the parents, who are very, very, let's say, mentally disturbed individuals, because they lack empathy and they inflict a lot of pain onto children, and they won't stop doing that. So yeah, not a very healthy, safe environment for humans to be growing up in. So these people would require quite extensive, in-depth, very effective therapy from people who understand this type of, let's call it, narcissistic abuse and toxicity. We want to be a highly proficient, trauma-informed person to be able to help these people come out of the denial and the defences and the trauma and the pain and anxiety, stress, and whatever else they're experiencing that has them act in the ways that they are acting as adults. We're all responsible for our own recovery and our own actions when we come into adulthood. So that is the way it works. So the idea that time heals all wounds is a myth. Time does not heal all wounds, not in a dysfunctional family, not when there's a child being ostracized, bullied, rejected, and that child's siblings are being encouraged, trained, given brownie points to really bully and hurt that child. Time doesn't heal all wounds. Intensive trauma-informed therapy can heal those wounds. And maybe we can ask ourselves, are those people seeking support and therapy? And if they're not, how can they possibly change? What is going to change it? Time is not going to change it, because those neural pathways are very deeply entrenched, and they've been doing the same behavior for decades and decades and decades. And let's ask ourselves, what would it take for them to change that behavior? So I'll move on to myth number three, which is similar to myth number two, but worth talking about, which is things will improve when the parent or parents are deceased. So when they pass away, and okay, so that generation is now passed away, and now it's just the siblings. So hopefully now, like, it was the parents that were orchestrating and manipulating and exploiting and playing one sibling off against the other. So they're out of the picture. So now we've got hope again. Here's the H word again coming back in. And this is a myth, because it can definitely be the opposite that happens when a parent is deceased, or maybe when after the second parent is deceased, so that it's just the children now. So the scapegoat and their siblings, and that scapegoat might be clinging on to hope. Oh, maybe now I'll get to see my nephews and nieces, because previously it was the parent that was the the go-to person that I couldn't communicate with my nephews or nieces because it went through the parent, all this type of triangulation. And with that person now out of the picture, now my siblings will be willing and able to have healthy relationships, and they'll understand everything that happened. They'll have empathy for me, and maybe I can talk to them, maybe I can explain things to them, and that's all it takes, is just one conversation. They're suddenly, after 3 decades, 4 decades, more decades, suddenly going to have this flash of inspiration and have empathy, have the quality of empathy. So this can be a false hope for us. So just dispelling this myth. So it also kind of ties in with that the parents were somehow innocent in all of this cult that is the dysfunctional family. Like, it's a family. The parents were the adults and you and your siblings were children. So back to that point where the parents decide the values and how healthy the family unit is. So I did work with a client once, and she was at the particular stage where her parent had passed away, and she was in a grieving process, and she had a lot of hope. It was her mother that passed away, and she had a couple of sisters, and she had such a desire that and hope that the siblings that she would be able to have a relationship with her siblings. So as she was taking sessions with me, it was maybe a month after her mother had passed away, and she was navigating a lot of the details of the passing of her mother and all the paperwork and stuff like that with her sisters. And boy, was it heartbreaking to witness what she was going through, and that level of hope, and the shock that goes with all of it as well, the grieving process. But the big piece there that I remember with that client was, couldn't wrap her head around how difficult the sisters could be, and now that their mother had passed away, that, you know, they couldn't have any bit of kindness. It was the opposite, and this is very common, that when a parent dies, it's definitely not a case that, oh, it brings people together. It's the opposite. There can be absolute carnage. Excuse the pun there, but things can definitely get worse, get a lot more stressful, and things can really, really ramp up. So just wanted to share those points to unpack a few things, and education is power in this situation. It's good to be mentally prepared and not going in blind to these situations. As the family scapegoat, we've endured enough of the brainwashing, enough of the manipulation, enough of the exploitation. We were very vulnerable to that when we were a minor. And when we're an adult, we really want to be savvy to exactly what's going on. Yes, it will be painful. Yes, it will be heartbreaking. But I would rather you know the truth about that than be forging ahead with false hope that is going to be more painful in the future for you. So I hope that was helpful for you today, and I'd love to hear any comments that you have, or if you have that experience, or if you have any, if you're working through the confusion around that. Thanks for listening, and see you in the next video.